Games in this podcast range from E to M.
Hi, it's Larry Hryb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to the official Xbox podcast. We are so happy that you joined us, that you liked and subscribed and did all those great things and rang the bell. Let's bring in the gang here. We've got Jeff over there on the left and Rebecca on the right. How you guys doing? Good to see y'all. Back for another week.
We're all back together. Yeah. I guess it was just me that took last week off.
Together.
Yeah.
In our natural habitat.
That's right. I totally forgot you were gone last week, Rebecca. You've actually been quite busy, and we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But it's been a fun week of playing games, at least for Jeff and I. I know that we've had some fun stuff, and so we'll just get right into that. And Jeff, why don't we start with you? What do you got going on behind you?
Yeah. So last week when we were talking about playing Fall Guys, and we ended up playing with Phil. By the way, I've gotten zero more crowns since that time, but it is what it is.
Phil and I are lucky ones.
Exactly. Well, during that, while we were playing, we were just sort of talking about some other games, and he had mentioned Trek to Yomi as being just a visual masterpiece that looks like it's like an old Japanese film. And so I started playing it. I mean, I've got to take the recommendation from Phil, right? I can't just be like, yeah, sure, whatever. Right. So I downloaded it.
You can't dismiss it. Yeah,
whatever. Turns out
the man knows
really
games.
Good.
Yeah.
He knows what he's talking about. So it's got this old sort of like Seven Samurai sort of visual film-esque quality to it. And it never gets old. And I would say it's essentially a 2D hack and slash in a way. And so in terms of like, you're usually one-on-one or one on a small group, and you can just parry and attack, and you learn different slashes and, you know, things like that. But the gameplay is relatively simple. And in my mind, and there's a couple bosses that I may have had some trouble with, but never for very long. It's just like, I get to keep seeing this world, and it sort of brings home like that sort of that motif, which we don't see all that often, I would say, in Western film in a really interesting way. And so I would say highly recommend it. It's in Game Pass. So Trek to Yomi, give it a shot. I think it's only like 6 or 7 hours long. And I just enjoyed, every bit that I've played of it.
You know, the Overwatch 2 beta is out now, and you can go download that. But so the other evening, Jeff, you and I were trying to play, and we had some timing issues because we had some family stuff going on. But I jumped on, so I was playing it, and I was like, oh, this is Overwatch. And Phil sends me a party invite, and so I take the party invite, we're chatting, and he's like, oh, I want to download it. So he went, and you have to buy this add-on pack that allows you access to the beta, right?
There's a couple different ways. So they had a sort of an application, or you could sort of enter to be part of the beta. We'll actually be speaking with the VP of Overwatch, which I always considered myself to be that, but it turns out there's a real VP of Overwatch who probably makes the game a little bit later on, Jon Spector, and we can talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah.
Exactly. Looking forward to that. And if you were not selected for that, and you definitely want to get in now, then yes, there's a pack that you can buy that will get you stuff for Overwatch 2's launch in October, but gets you into this beta now that will be going on for the next, I want to say, several weeks. So it's, I didn't want to wait, so I got it.
Yeah, like Junkyard Queen looks really cool. Like the cinematics for Overwatch are really good, so I've seen that, but haven't actually played now.
Oh, you should. Maybe we
it's
can
very
play
team
when it
based.
Comes out, as Jeff said later this morning. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is in a battle royale, and I think a great example was when we were playing Fall Guys last week. You could just go on like a run, and hey, guess what? I won the whole thing. In Overwatch, it's such a team sport that even if you've got someone who's just unstoppable, it still can be challenging for that one person to completely determine everything that's happening if the rest of the team is not on it. So yeah. I feel like a team of like that of well collaborating amateurs can sometimes do really, really well, as opposed to, you might an all-star that isn't playing really well with the rest of their team. And, team composition and all this stuff really matters, and saying, okay, we're not working out well. I'm going to switch to this other character who's going to really be able to counter what they're doing, and then they can do the same. And it's an ongoing sort of
buffs.
That's why it's a good esport, I think, is no two games seem to, necessarily play out the same way. So I've been playing Really getting used to it because traditional Overwatch is 6-on-6. Overwatch 2 is 5-on-5. And that really opens up the map. And I found that as a support character, I have to be a lot more careful because I've usually, a lot of times I've stood close to a tank while doing, you know, healing and, you know, contributing where I could offensively. Well, there's only one tank if you're playing in the role queue and there's two healers. Right. And if you're, and so I found much more frequently the opponent's DPS is getting behind the lines and getting me in the back and I'm gone. And so I've got to really, I have to smarten up, I think, the way I play and improve my communication, I think, with other players or, you know, stick with maybe a more mobile support character like Lucio, who can get away from bad situations. And if I'm playing with a less mobile character, maybe sticking closer than exactly stick closer with the tank if I was using like Baptiste or something. So anyway, it's interesting to see that. But even the classic characters, Larry, have been reworked in ways, sometimes in really big ways, like Doomfist or Orisa, or sometimes in very subtle ways, which I'm still trying to figure out. I felt like some of my moves, I was like, wow, I'm doing a lot more damage.
We talked about Bastion on text, right?
Bastion's also a really big rework because it can use that sort of tank mode and then move like without its ult. So I'm trying to figure like when should
but
I
then
be
the
scared?
The ult is like the ult is kind of like this, you know, area of denial in some regards.
Yeah. There's certain things where I'm like, that thing never used to give me trouble. And now, you know, Molten Core is one
that?
Of them where I'm like, yeah, exactly. And Orisa throwing a spear at me. And I was like, well, that's not something I used to have to worry about. So it's a cool adjustment and it's in the beta period. So I'm looking forward to talking to Jon Spector and asking him like, you know, what the team is looking for in this particular beta and what things we might expect to see add and change between now and October when the full game launches. And by the way, that will be free to play. So.
And
thanks.
There'll be a story mode too. Looking forward to that.
In 2023 from what they've been saying.
Further on.
We'll talk about that too.
Okay.
Yeah. So a lot of Overwatch too. Rebecca, what have you been up to?
Yeah, it's been a busy month. So we did the podcast in studio with Jeff. And so I briefly talked about Minecraft Legends, which is the newest game from Mojang Studios. And it's what I've been spending most of my time on. But aside from that, my team also did a creator summit. So we used to do these in person in Stockholm and invite content creators from around the world to come and hang out with Mojang folks at the Swedish office. Obviously, with the pandemic, we couldn't do that. So we transitioned to a virtual format. And so we actually did like a get together a week and a half, 2 weeks ago. It was virtual. Yeah. So it was so we basically just did some like presentations, some mingling, played games together, hung out on Discord. It was a cool experience. It was a lot of work for my team, but it's always really good to like kind of foster those relationships with like content creators. They're so important to the gaming community and to the Minecraft team in particular. I also have a few like goodies. So we sent out like little care packages to everyone. Like, hi, hope you're getting excited for the summit. So I have a few items I just want to share because I sent one to myself because why not?
You got to test it out. Quality assurance.
Right.
It's just good. It's just good.
So I have a hat.
A dad hat.
It's not a dad hat.
Got some socks because the Minecraft. So the wild update. Aren't these so cute? Yeah. So the wild update just came out in Minecraft, which includes frogs, and we love frogs. So the whole summit was kind of frog themed. We even had little like stickers and magnets that had the frog and our little logo on it. And then really cool is this big ceramic mug. And this is like an actual mug.
That's like the mug you put on your table to hold pencils and things, right? Because it is massive.
I do have a plastic one of those back at my desk in Redmond, holding like highlighters and stuff. But this one's nice. I mean, you could put hot liquids in there. It actually is available on Amazon.
Is any of this stuff available for people that can buy it?
Yeah. So this one you could get it at Amazon or like different retailers. I think I saw it like Walmart, Target. It's pretty widely available. It's just Minecraft ceramic mug. There's like different mobs and different like
feel like I've seen a creeper one.
Different mugs before. Too. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The creeper one's so popular. The TNT Classic. One. I think there was like a news anchor who had the TNT one on his desk one time. And our whole Minecraft team was like, oh my God, it was like the coolest thing ever. Amazing. We were like, oh, we made it. Anyway, so I've been really busy with that. I've been, you know, visiting some friends and family in the Bay and in Seattle and just kind of, I don't know why I packaged these things around the busiest time of the year, but anyway, so yeah. I haven't been home that much, but I have been home for the last like 4 days. And so I've been catching up on some TV. I finished Obi-Wan Kenobi on Disney Plus.
Oh yeah. I'm yes. only like 3 or 4 episodes in, so
okay.
Yes, we'll keep this spoiler free, but I'm enjoying
it. So spoiler free, but I will say, don't give up, because I was not super enjoying it all the way through, but the final episode and a half, I was like, okay. Like I actually came away with like a pretty good feeling about it last night. Briefly, I'll mention, I started playing before I took off for like 3 weeks. Started playing Lost in Random. It's really good. I picked it back up. So it's a third person action adventure, very Tim Burton-esque. I think I talked about it a little bit on the last mm-hmm. episode we did before we went dark, but it's really good. Still playing through that, kind of learning the story and the rules of the world. It's a world that's bound by rules and dice and things like that. It's a pretty cool concept. But then one other thing I wanted to ask was if you guys have played Marvel Avengers. I feel like I've heard a little bit about this. It's just an action adventure game, but it kind of takes some of the storylines from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But I wanted to ask because I saw that we announced that they're adding Mighty Thor, aka Jane Foster, to the game, and I was like, oh, that's so cool. I don't know, have you guys ever played that one?
I played through the campaign when it first came out.
Jeff has. I don't really participate in the Marvel universe.
Oh, that's right, barking up the wrong tree there. Yeah. I forgot.
A lot of the story really focuses around Kamala Khan, and so that's why coming in with Ms. Marvel, which I've really been enjoying, a new episode every week or so. I think we're up to episode 4 maybe this week. She's a character that you end up using within the game. Mm-hmm. It's definitely a little bit different than in a TV show, but ultimately she was sort of a fun and interesting character. And you do get to go through the different, you know, you choose Iron Man at one point and Black Widow and Captain America and Hulk. And I think that might be it. But then they've added characters since. So I have not played since I beat the campaign very early on, but yeah, very cool to see them adding in Jane Foster, right?
Yeah. So. Yeah, I figured it's on Game Pass. So Thor Love and Thunder comes out next week, I believe.
Is it? It's soon.
No.
It's definitely soon.
I thought it was July 8th.
I'm not going to argue with you. You're probably right.
Well, I figured that after watching that, it'll be a good time to hop in. It's on Game Pass. New content's been added. So anyway, just throwing it out there.
Jeff, we've got some news that we want to roll over before we get into these beefy interviews. Can you bring us up to speed, if you would, please?
Sure can. Actually, there's a lot of games that have updates, and that was one of the ones I had on there. So additional games with updates. A big one that we saw and a lot of people were playing at Play Days at Key3 is Outriders World Slayer. So Outriders, you know, that was a day one Game Pass game last year, I want to say. Spent a lot of time with that. But this World Slayers update is a huge new, it's a add-on, you have to pay for it, content with a new campaign, new features, a new end game. So a whole lot of stuff. It's like a really big addition, and that is available now in early access. So if you enjoyed Outriders, you want more of it, you want to see some of the new features that they're bringing, this is a huge meaty update for that. Tiny Tina's Wonderland also has a big update called Molten Mirrors. And so there's new bosses. There's 4 weeks of bosses, loot, combat, all kinds of stuff there. That is a game I've been meaning to get to and is prominent on my stack of shame. And a few other games. The Hunter, Call of the Wild, Roller Champions also have new updates. And in more Japanese gaming news, very excited that this week, Star Ocean, The Divine Force, which is the latest Star Ocean game that series goes all the way back to the PlayStation 1, which is when I first played it. So looking forward to playing Star Ocean: The Divine Force, coming to Xbox October 27th. It's published by Square Enix. It's made by Tri-Ace. So really like a great pedigree and classic JRPG action. Very much looking forward to that one.
Fun. Far Cry 5 is available now with Game Pass. He and I have spent a lot of time in Hope County getting into a lot of trouble.
Punching cows for achievements. Not my proudest moment.
Let's just say the bovine the bovines are not happy with us. So
we were tenderizing, Larry. A lot of
that was the silliest. Remember, it was dark. It was like at night, and we're out there just punching cows. It felt like I was in college again. It was weird.
Yeah, I think that was the first Far Cry where you could play like all parts of it in co-op, if I recall correctly. Yeah. And so we immediately honed in on some of the weirder achievements and decided let's go for these at the very beginning of the game. Because I think we wanted to get that game's all about the silent sniper rifle. Once you get that, you're like, you're pretty much set for much of the game. Yeah.
Okay.
It's OP. But yeah, Far Cry 5 available now. So if you have a Game Pass buddy, if you have a friend who has Game Pass, and you should, all your friends should have it, go play the co-op. Jeff and I highly recommend it. Another title that's in Game Pass now is something called House Flipper, which is pretty much exactly what you think it is. Buy a house, renovate it, and sell it. So that's apparently it's now Real Estate Simulator. That's now available in
Game Pass. Hey, those Sims they're relaxing. They're a good way to unwind at the end of the day.
I did the lawnmower one a couple times. I mean, you're right. They absolutely are. And there's Sims for all sorts of crazy stuff. I have a friend of mine, one of the kids in the neighborhood up the street plays lawn mowing simulator in his VR, and he won't cut the real lawn, and his mom's really mad at him. It's the strangest dynamic.
You just start giving out achievements for that.
Yeah. ignoring real world chores to do online chores.
Virtual stuff. I have to go double click on that a little more. Anyway, we've got some interviews. Rebecca, can you bring us in these interviews? Because it is quite a week of interviews.
It's a lot. All right. So first up, as you might have guessed from Jeff's shirt over there, Cuphead. So first up, we have Maja and Chad Moldenhauer. They're going to come on and talk to, I think, Larry about Cuphead, the delicious last course. Yep. Excellent naming for everything Cuphead. Then we have Jon Spector coming to talk about Overwatch 2. As Jeff mentioned, he is the VP of Overwatch 2, not Jeff. Then we have Mike Lucero and Harrison Hoffman, both from the Samsung team, but Mike's going to talk about Samsung TVs, and then Harrison's going to talk about the Samsung Xbox app. So let's get into this.
The delicious last course for Cuphead is now available, and joining us today is our good friends from Studio MDHR. How you guys doing, Maya and Chad? It's always great to have you on the show.
Fantastic. It's always great to be here. We love you, Larry, and the whole team. So we're very excited to be able to celebrate a day like today with you.
This is exciting. I mean, this is this DLC. I mean, it's this many years in the making, right?
I
mean, it's
I know, it depends on where you read it. 10 years, 15 years, 8 years. In truth, to be honest, we probably announced it a little bit too early.
Yeah.
It's fair to say. we get very excited. But we really put pencil to paper in 2019. But at the end of the day, quality comes first. And until it was exactly what we wanted it to be, it wasn't going to come out before that. So we're very proud of what we delivered.
And I think we can honestly say this is a really good lesson for don't announce too early, you fools.
Yeah, well, that's always one of the things. You learned a valuable lesson. But
yeah.
So, I mean, let's talk about it. You guys have had, since we talked, I think about, when you originally announced it, like probably, or like confirming it like a year ago, but a lot has happened since then. I see Cuphead on Netflix. You certainly have the DLC. There's like merchandise. I mean, this thing is just, the rocket ship continues to go like this for Cuphead. How has that been? Because I remember both you, Chad, and mine, of course, your brother Chad, when we would meet at E3, 2015 or 14 or 15, whatever it was, right? And you guys were on this journey, and so to be, and certainly, you know, I was watching it from an arm's length away. It's just been so exciting to see Cuphead become, you know, this video game and frankly cultural phenomenon in the late 2000s. So I want to congratulate you on that.
Thank you. Well, thanks so much. It's just as foreign to us as well. Looking backwards, you can connect all the dots, but back in 2014, 2015, there was no way we could have forecasted or foreshadowed where we would be today. We're so grateful for Netflix for giving us this opportunity and bringing the IP to like a whole new genre of entertainment. It has been a wild year.
It's humbling too, in a way. It's just to be in this situation, and we're super, super lucky for how everything worked out. It's just, we always say this, but we're pinching ourselves all the time.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel quite real. It's almost like a fairy tale.
I know, we've been so repetitive in terms of saying like, we're shocked, we're stunned, we're so excited, we're thrilled, but that feeling has not gone away at all. And so it's hard to come up with some new feelings, because it's been a wild ride.
All right, let's get to it. What is the delicious last course all about? I mean, you kind of see it here. Let me bring down the audio. It's looks like Miss Chalice, we got some good platforming action, but how would you describe the delicious last course for Cuphead?
Yeah. Well, DLC in a nutshell is our biggest island yet. It's 5 supersized bosses, lots of secrets. Don't let any rock go unturned. There's lots more to discover that we're trying to, you know, keep under wraps for people who may not have had a chance to play it in the last day. But what you're seeing here is one of our bosses, Mortimer Freeze. And this is his last phase. And we see Miss Chalice with using her super just now. And some of her new movesets in terms of the fact that she has a double jump. She comes with an extra HP. She she uses a dash to parry. And she has an invincible roll as well. So one of the key things about DLC is that it comes with this new playable character, Ms. Chalice, who is built from the ground up. She's not a reskin of Cuphead and Mugman. Thousands and thousands of new frames just for her alone. And we think it's going to give experienced players a whole new way of playing the game all over again in a kind of a new way.
Yeah. And we're super excited that like our fans get to take Miss Chalice and play with her in the original game as well, not just in DLC. And that was a big thing we always push for, because it she plays different enough that the game almost feels new in a way.
Yeah, right. It definitely does.
And aside from that, the other fun things are that we kind of pushed our craft to the limit. You know, within the 1930s era boundary, we still pushed ourselves towards that Fantasia realm. You know, we amped up the amount of animation and the large scale of the big band and orchestra. So everything is kind of like ratcheted up to that next level.
Now, it's interesting because Maya talked a little bit about Miss Chalice, who you can play in the downloadable content. You said a couple things there. She's got a double jump. She's got increased HP. But she's not like God mode, right? I mean, it's not
No. Definitely not. In fact, to play as Miss Chalice, you have to equip a charm. And so you actually lose that charm. And so to kind of bring it back, she's a bit of an amalgamation of all the other charms. But to say that she's like an easy mode or God mode or anything like that is not the way that we built her or intended her for her to be. It's just a whole new and a different way to experience it. For me, personally, I love her double jump, but I don't do well with the dash parry. I prefer Cuphead or Mugman's timing the parry instead. So I think it's just going to cater to a wider audience, maybe in terms of different capabilities.
Yeah, it's about having more options. So somebody might be struggling with a certain boss fight, and instead of equipping a charm for Cuphead and Mugman, they'll play as Miss Chalice. And because she plays so much differently, that might be the edge they need for that boss. But there also could be another boss where Cuphead and Mugman feels more natural. So it's just adding to our, like, the player's toolkit.
You know, you guys talked about, Maya, just a moment ago, about there were all new animation and so forth, the DLC and thousands of frames and so forth. But other than not announcing too early, what else have you learned from this DLC?
We're very bad at putting a line in the sand in terms of scope and kind of where to stop. The beautiful thing about 1930s animation was there were no boundaries, and you could, you know, the sky was the limit. You took inanimate objects, you turned them into something totally different. There were no restrictions. And so we kind of really take that to heart in terms of constantly pushing the boundaries, and like, what if the wizard turned into this and did this and had this much longer of an intro? And so we really need to pull it in sometimes and learn to kind of stop and say, okay, this is good enough for this boss, and let's move on to the next. But it's been fun. Like,
No, it's been amazing. But it's a little bit of coming into animation, like what let's call this film quality animation, a little green. So you do these things where you have stretch goals to make an intro for a boss look really cool and have a lot of energy in it. And you not blindly go into it, but you go into it thinking it's going to be a lot of work. But some parts of Cuphead DLC, the intro for a boss has almost as many frames as an entire boss in the original Cuphead.
Yeah.
And it's that kind of stuff that can add up fast. And part of DLC maybe is just our studio growing and learning too.
Yeah.
Yeah. It looks beautiful. I want to point something out though, because the game is famously unforgiving, the base game. To the point of embarrassingly, I haven't finished it yet. So for the DLC,
don't admit it.
I will admit it. I'm always
be
open
proud
and honest.
About it. Be proud. Okay,
but I do. I've got it up here behind me. But do people need to finish the base game to get to the DLC, or how will they access the DLC? I want to ask you that question because this a lot of people want to know.
Yeah, no. So DLC in itself is a natural progression and extension to the core game, but you don't have to finish the core game in order to experience it. You only have to beat one mausoleum, and then a mystery character will appear at a nearby shore or dock, and you talk to them, and they will take you over to DLC Island.
So if a player has already played the game and has a save file, a lot of people will just be able to jump into that save file, find the mystery character.
So if I'm far enough in the game, will it proactively unlock? Is that the way it works?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you're far enough, as long as you beat that first mausoleum, that character will be at a nearby shoreline that you can talk to.
Another excuse to go explore this fantastical island that you all have created and that's straight out of the 30s and 40s animation. I absolutely love it. It's really, it's such a delight to be able to play the game and enjoy the just artwork. I mean, I've always talked for many years, I've talked about the artwork of video games, and I will never, there's two games that stopped me dead in my tracks in my years in gaming. One of them was BioShock because I love Art Deco and I was a diver. Yeah. I was like, what? And the second is your game.
That's a tall order.
I'm serious because as a fan of animation, my sisters and I grew up with that animation, we were little, much like you guys did. We've talked about this on previous shows, that when it stopped me dead in my tracks, it spoke directly to my youth. And that's I love
about it. That makes us so happy because that's exactly what we intended to do for ourselves, being like, what would be a cool game that we would want to see?
Yeah.
And so to find that parallel in you as well is huge.
But there's so much stuff that we haven't showed yet that I like. It's people like you who want them to see, because there's some, we pushed ourselves in a lot of ways, and we have to give a big shout out to the entire team.
Oh my gosh.
Even when you think of the art side, it's a 2D game and it seems like, oh, maybe it's not, doesn't push the limits, but we, in a lot of ways, we're pushing the video RAM limits for having that many frames stored in memory. So there's a ton of moving parts just to get this right. And we hope that our fans are blown away.
I mean, in some ways, creating a standard regular cartoon that you tried to recreate in a video game is much easier. It's 24 frames a second, right? It's one. Yeah. You have so many more things to areas to look at. So it's so great that you guys are finally shipping Cuphead's Delicious Last Course, available now, and it's available on. I mean, this is an Xbox podcast, certainly available on Xbox podcast. But it's available on all the other platforms as well. Feel free to shout, give those a shout out if you want to.
Yeah, Xbox, like you said, PlayStation, Nintendo Switch, and GOG.
And Steam.
Steam.
Yes. Don't forget Steam. Yeah, it's
we're and again, tired.
I know you guys are. So again, congratulations to you and the entire team on shipping the Delicious Last Course, available now. And it's reasonably priced as well, right? Depending upon what platform you're on, but it's just
absolutely $7.99 USD, and then respective in your whatever currency,
whatever region you're in.
You shop in.
Maja and Chad from Studio MDHR, great to talk to you about Cuphead. I mean, I say this all the time. I could talk to you guys forever. I just, don't want to wait another 5 years to talk to you again. So good luck.
No.
we're getting smarter. It's going to be quicker.
Yeah.
I promise.
All right. Again, congratulations on the launch. And on behalf of all the gamers and animation fans out there, thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you so much. Thanks to all of our fans. Thanks to everybody who made this possible. It would not have been possible without the response and feedback and love that we've received over the last 5 years. We're very grateful.
There is no game I have played more over the last decade than Overwatch. It has just completely resonated with me, my family. And I got to tell you, when the Overwatch 2 beta became available this week on Xbox, I was in there hour one. And I've got a lot of questions. I'm wondering a lot of things. And well, who better to speak to than someone with probably the best title in gaming, Jon Spector, the VP of Overwatch. Thanks for joining us this week.
Hey, Jeff. Thanks for having me. It's awesome to be here.
So I would love to know just sort of like in the arc from Overwatch 2 getting announced to coming out in October 4th. Where are we sort of in this timeline right now with Overwatch 2?
Yeah, I think we're in the sort of most exciting phase now of the home stretch to launch. So we just started our second beta test this week, and now we have players on Xbox and PlayStation getting a chance to join us and test things. And this for the team is, I think, both a just really important and exciting milestone, but also as we look ahead to October, it's another really good opportunity to go gather player feedback and make sure that we're setting ourselves up for success with the launch later this year.
So I know there's a lot of types of things you could be looking at with this beta. There's sort of like, metrics on the back end, stuff that just by playing it, Blizzard's able to benefit and know, okay, there's choke points here on this new map, or maybe we need to tweak this, damage from this character or something to that effect. Is there also sort of like that qualitative feedback that you're looking for from the fans that are playing? And if so, how would they be able to communicate that to you?
Yeah, so the beta is incredibly important as a source of feedback for really the entire team. And we all kind of have our different things that matter to us. And so if you're on the hero design team, right, you're much more attuned to, we've just released Junker Queen. How is she performing? We will be looking at pick rates, which I assume will be incredibly high because everyone wants to try her, but then also win rates for players of different skill level. We'll be reading comments about how she feels to play. Is she fun? Is she exciting? Impactful? And then if you go to other parts of the team, right, we'll be looking at how is server stability working as we're adding more and more players. Even in the first 24 hours since this beta started, we've not surprisingly logged a fairly decent list of, hey, we need to fix this type of thing or polish that type of thing, where the ability to test at scale now just dwarfs even what we're able to do internally. We've been playtesting this stuff, and we've have an incredible QA team that spent a ton of time on this build, but getting it out to players, seeing it tested at scale and gathering all that feedback is huge. So we have our teams listening on our various forums, social platforms, and then also we'll just be monitoring all of the data as we look at what are people playing, which heroes are they picking, how are they performing, all of that type of stuff too.
All right. Pretty comprehensive. And that's what you would expect over the course of the next few weeks as this second beta is going on. First beta for Xbox. So as you mentioned, see a lot of people picking Junker Queen, usually out of the two tanks that I'm seeing. It's double Junker Queens on either end, and a lot of Sojourns as well, because this is on Xbox, our first chance to get a hold of her. And having, as a support character, been on the wrong end of Sojourn, I need to figure out how to counter her as soon as possible. So let's talk about, I think if you were coming as an Xbox player and you've been playing Overwatch, several years at this point, and you've probably heard things like, okay, it's 5-on-5, going at least with role queue going to, the single tank. But what are the other things besides new maps and some very reworked characters? What are the things people should really be looking out for and making sure that they appreciate and sort of understand here in this Overwatch 2 beta?
Sure. Yeah. The scope of the shift, I think, from the Overwatch 1 experience into even just this beta test, right, let alone Overwatch 2 when we launch in October, is massive. And that's, as you mentioned, the new heroes and the new maps, and we have a new game mode push. the transition to 5v5, I think, is one of those things where, from my perspective, at least as a player, it feels a lot more impactful to go play in that 5v5 environment. And like, I have more of an individual opportunity to really have an impact when I'm playing well in the game. And I think that's one of those shifts as well, where actually playing it and experiencing it, like I can talk about it at length here, but I think the best way for players to really understand what that means for the game and the positive shift there is to go experience it, to test it out in the beta, to play it in October. Under the hood, we've also just made a ton of changes too. There's been a lot of engine optimization and tools optimizations. There are some features, even when we look at where Xbox was when Overwatch 1 came out versus some of what you can do on the platform today, our sound team has had a really good time going through and making sure that we're taking more full advantage of the capabilities that are newer to Xbox now. And there's some of those types of things too, where I forget the exact number, but it's tens of thousands of new voice lines that we've gone and added for the heroes that make them come to life in a way that's just, we know so many people love and are interested in the stories of these heroes. And some of the types of things we've done in Overwatch 2 are a little bit less flashy than, hey, look at this new hero, but I think still incredibly impactful in terms of what are players going to see and feel when they jump in and get to check it out.
All right. So this beta will be continuing through, I believe, July 18th. Or so. And right now, the if you haven't been selected, there was an opportunity over on overwatch.com to sort of submit, I don't want to say an application, but to sort of sign up to be part of it. Right now, the guaranteed way is to pick up the Watch Point Pack, which I know contains a number of skins and other features that will be valuable once Overwatch 2 comes out in October, but gets you into there directly. Are there other ways that you're looking at in being able to widen the pool of people who will be able to get into the beta as this continues on, or for other things that might be coming down the line?
Yeah, so I mentioned before, right, like one of our primary goals, actually the primary goal for this beta, and it's less flashy, right, but the number one thing that we're trying to do with this beta is get ready for October. And so that means that things like scaling up server stability and making sure that login flows are smooth and all of that, like it's number one, even above hero balance or testing out other new game features or things like that. And so what we've done is we opened up that free sign-up page, and we let in a bunch of those players yesterday too. And then every couple of days for the next few weeks, we plan to let in more players off of that list. And then finally, we think kind of as we head into the last phase of this beta, really, I think it's the middle of that final week. So 4 or 5 days before the beta wraps, that's when we've planned to say, hey, if you're on that signup list and you have not gotten in yet, we're going to pull everyone in then. And from talking with our team, we're confident that we'll be able to do that, even though the list of players is really long and we've been just blown away by the interest in Overwatch 2 from our players. As you mentioned, that Watch Point pack is another way in now, and players who go out and have bought that pack are granted immediate beta access when that comes in. Really is kind of a thank you for the early support of Overwatch 2 ahead of our October launch.
So keep an eye on the inbox. Just because you didn't get that that invite here in the first couple of days doesn't mean it's not coming. And then stay tuned for, I guess I would, if you're not already following, Overwatch social accounts to figure out when there might be an opportunity for a larger group to get in. So let's fast forward if we can. I'm sure you all are going to be very busy over the course of the next 3-4 weeks. But let's say it's now July 19th. The beta has closed. What is the first thing? What does the team do? And how do you then sort of take what I'm sure just reams of data, both numerical and qualitative, and make that final push to October 4th? What is the team going to be doing then?
Yeah, we actually don't even wait until the end of the beta to get going on some of this stuff, right? So even it's been 24 hours and the team has, hey, let's play test this change, or let's think about how we respond to that feedback or what we're seeing. This isn't, we're going to wait the 3 weeks and then oh, now we have everything we need. We're getting valuable information every day from our players and working to act on that. We also have a whole bunch of different features and content and systems that are not in this beta test that we're planning to deliver in October. And so a lot of how we'll spend the next few months is adding all of those various things to the build, getting our new support hero ready to launch in October as well, and finalizing some of those types of things. On top of, we're going to discover new opportunities to polish things up, to address bugs, to potentially make some additional balance changes and other things. And that's kind of the new information that I would say will come out from this beta test, whereas a lot of what we know we need to do for October, we've known for a while and the team has been working on.
Well, when that support character is announced, please make sure to share that information with us here so we can share it out, because, you know, I'm in danger of becoming like a Moira one trick, and I need to branch out here. So looking forward to more options there. So
we've got some Moira changes coming for you in the middle of this beta. The team's been working on that stuff, and we've teased it a little bit, but there actually is some fun coming for Moira players shortly. And then yeah, I think the biggest thing, right? Like, the new support hero is amazing. We can't wait to introduce them to the world, and we'll do that ahead of our launch too.
I don't know that anyone introduces new characters quite the way you all do, because it's not just here's what they are and what they do, but here's their story and all kinds of good stuff. So we'll be looking forward to that. And if you do read Xbox Wire, which if you're watching this, we will have all of that information for you. Making that commitment now. So let's talk about those of us playing Overwatch 1. I know I'm still grinding towards another gold gun, which I'm pretty close to getting. I would love to have in time for October. What happens to those who have Overwatch 1? You might have invested a lot of money into different skins and sprays and, you know, emotes and a million other things. Of course, you have a whole history of playing with all of these characters. What happens on October 4th to you?
So a core goal for our team this entire time has been to bring our players along for this journey with us and to do that as seamlessly as possible. And so on October 4th, if you're an Overwatch 1 player, you'll effectively be prompted to just go download Overwatch 2 and to have that come through sort of as the way that you would typically download an update, except using that language really sells short what it is. But from a technical perspective, that's effectively how it'll work, where, hey, you're now downloading Overwatch 2. And ahead of that, we're going to be sharing more details with players leading up to this moment. But we're also doing some of the tech work behind the scenes for things like being able to link up your accounts for cross progression, which for players who have played on console and want the opportunity to bring their collection with them to PC or vice versa, that's a pretty exciting thing that we're going to be able to do, where I've heard countless, hey, I unlocked this super cool exclusive skin back when I played on PC and now I play on Xbox and I don't have it and I wish I did. And we're going to be sharing more about how that works, but we'll do that ahead of October 4th. And then on October 4th, we're going to be bringing all of our Overwatch 1 players into that Overwatch 2 experience and doing that as seamlessly as we can. And you mentioned too, right, we know that players have put a ton of time, energy, and sometimes money as well into building their Overwatch 1 collection and obtaining skins that they love for these heroes. And we're making sure that you bring your collection along with you into Overwatch 2 as well.
Very much appreciated. I have a daughter who has unlocked every single D.Va unlock, and it's good to know that'll be intact and there'll be some cool stuff coming down the line. So last thing I just wanted to ask you, like you said, I mean, between the, you know, under the hood and the very visible changes with new characters and skins and everything, new modes, so many different things. Is there one thing that you can just sort of point out and say, I'm just like really proud of the team and really proud that we're going to be bringing this to, you know, to the Overwatch playing faithful on October 4th or even now in this beta?
Yeah, for me, it really is kind of the everything. Like, it feels unfair to say this is the one thing that I'm most excited about, because the team has just done so much to build and deliver an incredible experience to players. I think the thing that I'm proud of now is the team's ability to really pivot and shift our strategy to get a polished, amazing PvP release out this year. And Aaron and others on our team have talked about this, our game director have talked about this at length, but this was a shift in strategy for the team, where we'd been planning all of the PvP content and all of the PvE content to come out all at once at some future date. And we realized and have really shifted a lot of time, attention, and effort toward changing our strategy, where we wanted to be able to bring all of this amazing PvP experience to players sooner. And the team's done an incredible job of building the new heroes and the new maps and the new looks for all of our heroes and all of those under the hood improvements, different systems, in a way where we can deliver that in October and then continue to build on top of that with our season 2 update 9 weeks later, our season 3 update 9 weeks later, and then in 2023, starting to deliver those PvE experiences as well. So I'm just really proud of our team, I think, for being able to make that pivot and to deliver something that we're all really proud of for players this year.
Well, an exciting couple of weeks here for us beta players, and only 3 months really and change until we get to really begin this journey with Overwatch 2. Jon, I know you've got a lot going on as the VP of Overwatch, again, coolest title. So thanks for taking time to join us here on the official Xbox podcast.
Thanks for having me, and hope you continue to have a great time in the beta.
The Xbox app is now available across all 2022 Samsung smart TVs where cloud gaming is available. Joining me today is Harrison Hoffman, who helped build this amazing experience. Harrison, great to see you.
Hey, it's great to see you too, Larry. Thanks for having me on.
You know, it's funny. I know you've listened to the show for a long time, but this is the first time I've had you on the show. So welcome and apologies. You know, we've had opportunities, I guess, in the past, but we're thrilled to have you here today. Before we get into the news and the Samsung app availability, which is now available, tell us a little bit about what you do at Xbox and your journey and what brought you here.
Yeah, for sure. I'll just tell a quick story about my history with Xbox, if that's cool. So I got my first Xbox when Halo 2 came out when I was in high school, and like totally fell in love with it then. And, you know, getting on Xbox Live and playing with friends, just such kind of a formative moment. And then, you know, in the lead up to the Xbox 360 coming out in 2005 is when I actually started listening to your podcast. So the summer before the 360 release, I had a summer job at a golf course and like had all sorts of different jobs, you know, where it was cleaning carts and cleaning bathrooms, yep, and taking care of customers and all sorts of things. But my favorite part of the job was I got to drive the golf cart that picks up balls on the driving range. So people are, you know, trying to aim at you and hit you with golf balls, basically. And the good part about that job is I could bring my old school iPod, which was loaded up with the Major Nelson podcast, and yes, listen to your podcast while I was doing that job. So, you know, from there to, you know, I joined Team Xbox back in 2015 and have worked on sort of a bunch of different things since then. You know, most recently before this, I worked on the user experience for Series X and S for about 3 years before launch. And then after that shipped, I started to look at smart TV and how we can, you know, start bringing the Xbox experience to more people. So
and that's what brings. First of all, thank you for that. I'm so glad you're there. People aren't hitting balls at you anymore. but it's
a little bit better now.
It's so great to have you on the team and work on this. And of course, you're here today to talk about the Xbox app on Samsung televisions, the 2022 Samsung televisions. Tell us a little bit about, because it shipped a few days ago in the middle of the week. Tell us what this enables and what it does. And I have a little bit of video here to show you, but I want to have you kind of deliver the information here.
Yeah, for sure. So just a little bit of context first. So, you know, obviously you hear my background, like I'm a console guy, kind of come from the console world. I worked on Series X and S, and, you know, myself and the team just have tremendous appreciation for the gaming experience that consoles bring to the TV. And like, we look forward to continuing to innovate in that space. But we also know that not everybody is going to buy a dedicated gaming device like a game console to play for a variety of different reasons. So this is really all about just expanding access to Xbox gaming to more people. So what we've released today is the Xbox app for Samsung Smart TV. And that's going to be available in our cloud gaming markets across Samsung's 2022 line of TVs. You can just go into your Samsung TV, find the app in Samsung's gaming hub, and launch into it. All you have to do is pair your favorite Bluetooth controller, like an Xbox controller or even a PlayStation controller. And then you're off and playing games on your TV via cloud gaming with no console required. So obviously, as we announced, about a month ago now, you can get in here and play Fortnite for free, just logging in with a Microsoft account. And then if you're a Game Pass Ultimate subscriber, that's when you unlock, you know, hundreds of high quality games that you can just play directly via the cloud.
So. And I was showing a little bit of the user interface here, which you worked on, you know, certainly. And it's interesting because you're showing here that you can use all sorts of controllers with it. You don't even need an Xbox controller.
Yeah. And like, you know, now that we've taken, you know, dedicated hardware, you know, out of the equation, you know, the biggest barrier to entry for people trying the app is going to be just having a controller. So we wanted to make this work with as many controllers as we possibly could. So we partnered with Samsung on that to support all of the top, you know, Bluetooth controllers here. So we really just want you to be able to pick up any controller connected to your TV and just start playing.
And I know that and here we are. I mean, you're just going through here and you're browsing. This view may be slightly familiar because it's kind of inspired by the Xbox Series X and S user interface and what we know and are comfortable with. But to your point, you don't need a console anymore. I mean, your console essentially is in the cloud. But for those folks that are used to, you know, nobody buys a Netflix device, right? You just get Netflix on your devices. It's kind of opposite. And that's kind of the same thing that with what your team has built, where you already have the TV and people that may want to play, as you said, Fortnite, which is free to play, Minecraft Dungeons, Sea of Thieves, all the great games that you've heard about, you can now stream them directly to your device. That's pretty incredible.
Yeah, and I just think it's a really exciting moment in home entertainment because obviously over the past decade plus, like people have really gotten used to streaming movies and TV shows via apps like Netflix and Disney Plus and Hulu, etc. And you know, we just want to make it as easy to, you know, stream a game from Xbox on your TV as it is to stream a show from Netflix. Like it should be that easy.
Yeah, and the most important thing is, as we've said a couple times, you don't need a console, so you don't need dedicated hardware. You can just jump in, and there's you know, and your team, which built the app, works very closely with the xCloud team because obviously you need them to enable this experience. So tell us a little bit about what some of the optimizations, because I know you've been working on this for quite some time.
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, tons and tons of people have contributed to this project across all of our different organizations. So we've had people, you know, working on this project specifically for the past year plus. But, you know, we're really building on top of decades of foundational work in the Xbox ecosystem to make this happen. You know, obviously the amazing cloud gaming work that the xCloud team has done over there. You know, we have cloud game saves that are supported here. So you can, you know, play on any of your devices and pick up right where you left off. Achievements, friends, multiplayer, all that stuff that you'd sort of expect from the Xbox experience is here. So, you know, while there's a bunch of people working on the immediate project, you know, we're really kind of standing on the shoulders of all the previous Xbox teams who have built things up here. So, you know, really the biggest thing for us with this app was making sure that the gameplay felt great and was fun. Cause like you have to have that responsiveness. The game has to feel right when you play it or else it's not going to be fun to play. And then we don't really have anything. So, you know, the first part of this project, you know, we spent a lot of time working on and optimizing the video streams and the audio streams and like the quality of those and how they're delivered. We spent a lot of time on our side as well as in partnership with Samsung, just reducing the latency as much as possible and making the controls feel as responsive as they can possibly be. And, you know, the end result is, you know, a very fun and responsive, you know, gameplay experience that you can just jump into here.
Yeah. And I mean, we've seen here, you're playing Halo Infinite, you know, via on a Samsung television. And it's great because it's just familiar. It's just like, and there's the guide. You've got a little mini version. It's like a cloud guide in there. So it's a little bit different. Yeah. But it's, again, it's familiar. All the elements are there that you know and that you love. So it's just, it's so great to see all of that. But what I'm excited about is, you know, you and I and everybody listening and watching knows, you know, Phil Spencer has talked about reaching the 3 billion gamers. And this is one of the bricks in that 3 billion gamer path. Right. This is one of the ways we get there. Certainly, yeah. We're going to have consoles for people that want to play consoles and so forth. But allowing people that already have a television to test out our services and play great games, that's an amazing on-ramp, isn't it?
Yeah, totally. And, you know, at Xbox, we're really just about giving gamers choice. Like if you want to play your games on a console or a PC or a phone or a web browser or a TV, we just want to open up more ways for you to play games. And that is how we're going to get to those 3 billion gamers, by just making our games and our services, you know, as accessible as possible to people. And, you know, I referenced kind of Netflix and Disney Plus and some of those other apps earlier. And like, you've really seen the way that they've been able to scale by just being ubiquitous and just being on every device and just giving people access.
And I also want to point out something that maybe folks don't know, in that, you know, this is a great opportunity if you have an Xbox console. Maybe you go to your friend's house or your brother's or sister's or mom or dad or whoever, and they've got a Samsung TV. Maybe you can log in and show them how to play a game, right? And kind of get started with them.
Yeah, totally. So, you know, I have my Series X, you know, hooked up to my big TV in my living room. And then downstairs, you know, I've got my 2022 Samsung TV mounted to my wall, just playing with cloud gaming. Like, I don't have to hassle with, you know, figuring out a place to get my console set up or anything. It's just simple and ready to go. And I think that, you know, what you mentioned with being able to kind of introduce friends to gaming is really interesting as well. And, you know, I'm always the one who's trying to, you know, get more people into gaming or get my friends to play, or, you know, bring people in. And this just makes it that much easier. You know, oh, you have a TV that has the Xbox app, here, take one of my extra controllers, and now we can just play together. And I'm just excited about all the new social opportunities that opens up.
Yeah, and it's also something that I want to point out, and it, people may know, but it's worth pointing out, is that when you sign in and you pick a game to play over xCloud on your Samsung TV, or frankly on a stream on any of our devices, your save game is right there, right? And that's, you know, I'm sure we all remember that first time where we stopped playing a show on Netflix and went to another device, you know, a month later. It's like, do you want to continue? Yeah, I do. You just keep going. And it's obviously a little bit more sophisticated for us because we've got a game save up, but all of that stuff just happens. You don't really have to worry about anything. We're following you around to where you're going as a gamer and bringing the gaming to you, and make sure you have all your stuff, right?
Yeah, we're just really taking care of everything behind the scenes for you. So, you know, if you play on your phone or your PC or your console or your TV, your progress is saved automatically, synced up to the cloud, so you can pick up right where you left off. Obviously, you can unlock achievements on the TV as well, and all of that is going to be sort of saved and synced. So it really is, you know, the Xbox experience that's built into an app on your TV. So,
and I know that a lot of folks are interested in, hey, you know, I have an older Samsung TV. Is it going to come to that? What's going on there?
Yeah, so we're launching today on 2022 Samsung TVs. Clearly, you know, we're going to evaluate opportunities to get this to more devices and more people in the future. So don't have anything new to share on that yet today, but I think you can see our 3 billion gamer goal and understand that this is something that we want to expand on. So.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, Harrison, as we've said, the 3 billion gamers, it's not that maybe we don't want to bring it to older TVs. Maybe there's a technology reason that doesn't. Maybe your TV, like I know my older TV doesn't even have Bluetooth, right? So it's
exactly. Yeah. So I mean, there are certainly some baseline requirements of devices in order to actually be able to have this experience. And then the other side of it is just like working really closely with our partners to test and optimize on these devices. So we've been working super closely with Samsung over the last year with their 2022 hardware, you know, iterating with them on the actual firmware on the TV, iterating on our side to really just tune the app and get the gameplay experience just right. So, you know, that's really what it's about for us, is making sure that the experience is going to be great when we deliver it to you. So,
well, it's again, as Harrison said right at the top of the interview, the Xbox app is now available across all 2022 Samsung smart TVs. You can play cloud gaming right there. Check it out. Let us know. Hit Harrison and I up on Twitter. I'll put your Twitter handle up here right now, Harrison. Hit us up. Let us know what you think. And I know your team is hard at work on continuing to evolve that story and bring gaming wherever people are. Phil always says we put the gamer at the center, and this is a fantastic example of that, right?
Yeah, for sure. And we're just really excited for people to start using it and like tell us what you think. Like, we are here to learn. We're here to make it better. So, would love to hear from folks, and just hope that folks enjoy playing on their TV.
All right, Harrison Hoffman, work on the connected TV apps. Appreciate all your help today and shipping it for the Samsung smart TVs, the 2022 smart TVs. Looking forward to having you on again in the future to tell us more news. All right.
Excellent. Thanks, Larry.
As you heard from Harrison, the Xbox app is now available on 2022 Samsung smart TVs. And joining us today is Mike Lucero, who works on gaming over at Samsung. Mike, welcome to the show.
So excited to be here. Such an exciting day for Samsung and Xbox, and thrilled that I'm able to share the excitement with the venerable Major Nelson.
I have to tell you, Mike, and a lot of people don't know this. You and I know this. I have been at Xbox for a long time, as a lot of folks know, but you are one of the people that is responsible for me being there. You are absolutely. You were back working on Xbox back in the day when I joined the team, and you were on my interview loop, if you remember correctly. And I remember it as if it was just, I remember having that chat in the Millennium, at the Millennium campus. So I want to thank you for many years of gaming awesomeness and bringing me into the team. But you were on Xbox. Tell us a little about your journey from Xbox and then onward into Samsung.
Sure. Yeah. So, and I'll try to keep it relatively short, but yeah, obviously Xbox Live was, you know, transformative in terms of its impact on gaming in general, and the overall gaming experience, you know, online multiplayer and all the other things that came with Xbox Live were really transformative. So I did Xbox Live. I was what's called a product planner there, and, you know, built that community up with your help. You're obviously the community leader there, which was what we were missing. That was like, we learned this really important lesson about community. Thanks to you. So thank you for having a great interview so I could give you two thumbs up. And then I went to, I did a couple other things. I eventually ended up doing bringing OTT to Xbox as well. So when
explain OTT, because a lot of people might not know that.
Yeah, actually, I brought that acronym OTT. It's over the top video. So Xbox does not get credit for this, but there was a period of time when more video was viewed on Xbox than any other platform. And it began with Netflix. And when these over-the-top video apps, which is now standard streaming, which is, so it's ironic that, you know, I'm bringing game streaming to the TVs as well. It's like kind of coming full circle. But, at the time, bringing video streaming to the Xbox was a whole new thing. And I actually talked to the product manager at Netflix a few years later, and he said, when we launched the Netflix app on Xbox, I think in 2008, they changed their entire business model. It was transformative for them.
Yeah.
And that's when they stopped sending DVDs and started just doing over the top video. So I was part of that whole movement. And then I joined, I brought Twitch to the Xbox.
Yep.
And that was transformative because we did it. It was a great partnership. And then it was transformative for me because I eventually went to Twitch. And the last time I saw you actually in person was it was at the Xbox anniversary party, but previous to then it was in Melbourne.
That's right.
At PAX.
I just got back from Melbourne, by the way.
Right, I saw that. Yeah, you had that fan fest.
Yeah, I was down there at fan fest. So it's just so funny that's I'm back again. But yeah, so as you were saying, we chatted at PAX in Melbourne.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And then, so I was at Twitch. I learned all about, streaming, live streaming for games, which is like a whole new phenomena. And then I joined Samsung because our president, Wan Jin, he had this sort of obvious epiphany that we have known for years that, gaming is the biggest form of entertainment out there. And, our gaming, our TVs are really optimized for media consumption, not gaming consumption. And so he said, Mike, I want you to figure out how do we actually take a bigger role in gaming? How do we actually become a member of the ecosystem versus just being sort of the last mile where people, see the pretty pictures? But
right. You plug something in the back and just kind of make it happen. Plug a console or a PC in the back, right?
Exactly, exactly. So how do we actually, drive, just like with, obviously we have all those, Netflix, Hulu, we have all that in our TV. without requiring a Roku or a Fire TV or anything like that. So likewise, how do we do this, a similar thing for gaming? And I said, well, you know, now is the time for, you know, for gaming to become game streaming, to become mainstream, because, you know, we've got experts like, you know, the xCloud, you know, infrastructure is, yeah, has been in the works for years, and it's, you know, it's profoundly effective, and we've got great TVs. And he said, I said, you know, we've got, with a combination of the tech that's out there with great content partners, and also that, you know, the tech we have on our TVs, I actually think we can create a great gaming experience that doesn't require a console. And I'm sure Harrison was effusive about how amazing the experience is, but
yeah,
you know, I think I feel so proud of what Harrison and I built, and obviously hundreds of other people. But, you know, we now have an experience that really democratizes gaming on our Samsung TVs. And that was, you know, Wanjin hired me to do that, in the fact that I was been here for a couple of years now. It took some time to build, but
yeah,
took less long than a console to build. So for what it's worth.
Well, and that, first of all, congratulations, because as Harrison said just a few minutes ago, right, it's available now on 2022 Samsung televisions. And I know that he kind of alluded to the fact that you're trying to figure out what other, you know, if you, what other TVs you can bring it to in terms of models and so forth. But it's a moment, because now for the first time ever, people can just take any, not only just an Xbox controller, but a PlayStation controller, any controller they have, and connect it to their Samsung television and be playing Halo Infinite in 5 minutes, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's amazing. It's so fast. I mean, the fact that you don't have to do downloads, there's no storage required to, you know, erase Call of Duty off your hard drive so you can, you know, load up a few more games. It's just, you know, it just, you know, it works seamlessly. And then the most exciting thing about it, I was just talking to Jared West actually about this, is that it really allows you to go between games, from game to game to game to game, just like you're flipping channels. You don't have to,
right,
you know, it's not this huge Herculean task of switching game. It's like, oh, I'm in the mood for Psychonauts. Oh, I'm really not in the mood for Psychonauts. Maybe I want to do, you know, flight sim. I'm feeling like a Zen flight sim moment. So maybe I'll do that and I'll fly over Italy or something like that. So, you know, the fact that you can seamlessly switch between games is just, you know, so refreshing and so sort of liberating as a gamer. It's like I can play whatever I want, whenever I want, and boom, you're in instantly.
So we talked to Harrison about the experience, but tell people a little bit, if you can just quickly breadcrumb them through what, if they've got a 2022 Samsung TV, where do they find this experience and how do they get going?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So obviously you buy your 2022 TV, and you know, if you already had one, you know, starting today or starting yesterday actually, we started doing a software, just like you guys do it on the Xbox team. We do a firmware update to all the 2022 TVs.
Yep.
So the gaming hub then live, you know, is downloaded to your TV along with a lot of the apps as well, including the Xbox. And then basically, you know, you have I wish I could have my TV with me here, but basically you've got your media row, and then you've also got your gaming, you know, the gaming hub, which is a different, it's like a system level menu.
Yep.
So you have a little controller icon, you go to the gaming hub, and then you've got a much completely different experience. It feels very much like a virtual console. It's got different colors, it's got your consoles there, it's got your game streaming apps, it's got Twitch, it's got YouTube, it's got Spotify, all these, you know, just like, I mean, there's no surprise that there's a lot of the things that people do on consoles, you know, we wanted to do that here too. So we wanted to do that, those types of integrations. So all that stuff, gaming in one place. And then if you have if you want to sign up for any, we've got, obviously we announced some other partners as well, but I'm here to talk about Xbox. But we have, you know, with Xbox, you can, you know, if you're a current subscriber, so first thing you do is you pair your controller, which is very simple through, you know, we go out of our way to make sure that it's, that you can easily pair the controller. It requires a remote control to actually go to the menu. But once you actually go to the, you know, the menu to pair it, then you can basically navigate through the entire TV with your controller, which is, you know,
that's kind of cool.
Super
too.
Important.
Here's an example of what it's like.
I love that. That's like a lighter.
Yeah.
I mean, just think that's like, you guys are really treating us like first class citizens, which is really what it's all about.
Well, I think your point is that, you know, you've got the display technology and we have all these TVs and living rooms, and, you know, Harrison and I were talking about, this is one of the many ways that Xbox gets to 3 billion gamers. You have so many, Samsung is the top leading manufacturer out there with your technology and so forth.
We've been the market leader since 2008 or something like that. Some absurd amount.
Do you remember back in the day when we all had the little Samsung HD TVs in our offices?
Oh yeah,
remember those ones with the red frame? And anyway, but that,
exactly,
because that was also a moment you talked about. A moment ago you talked about the transformative for Netflix and how we, Xbox streaming. But it was actually, you know, when 360 launched, that was really that was from the SD to the HD era, right? That was real. Everything was 16 by 9 and 720, 1080, and now we're up to 4K. But it was really a transformative moment, wasn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that was huge. I mean, it changed the whole sort of, it made it more theatrical, which is kind of what it's all about. You know, these immersive experiences really became immersive. And now, with, we've got a 1080p stream coming in from Xbox, but we, with our TVs, we can do, 4K upscaling.
Right.
So we can make it look like 4K. So again, this is where our companies working together is such an amazing partnership, because you guys have great games, you guys have great streaming tech. We have, we take latency out on our TVs. We reduce 30% of latency through our gaming mode. And then we do this AI upscaling and do a similar thing with audio. So we really do make it a great, we take it to that next level in terms of the actual user experience.
Yeah, you talked about that, because a lot of people get confused when they're playing games. Do I have gaming mode on? But if you're using the app on board, it handles all of that, correct?
Yeah, it's all in the background. Yeah, it happens automatically, which is
It's just fascinating how you talked about you started with Xbox Live, and then you're over at Twitch for a little while, and now you've just, games and internet have always been side by side for you, and now they're one, right? Now they're one thing. It's fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I feel very lucky. And that's what I love about gaming in general is, it's like, it never is dull. It's like, I was talking to somebody, it's like, so what does this mean for the console? And I said, well, now the consoles need to push a little harder, and they're going to push us harder. It's like there's always going to be this tension, and that's the beauty of gaming. It's like, we're always going to be pushed. It's not like video, where it just sort of continues on its linear sort of growth phase. It's like, we are innovating in a way that has never been, that continues to be surprising and unexpected and delightful for the gamers and creates new communities, which is what it's all about. So,
well, Mike, I appreciate you coming on and talking about it. And Harrison explained it in a little bit more detail, but it's great to hear from the Samsung perspective about, having Xbox app now available on the 2022 Samsung smart TVs with cloud gaming, go into your brand new gaming hub that's in there. If you have a 2022 Samsung TV, go in there and check the firmware update, take your firmware update, and then go check it out. And as you said, if you're an existing Xbox Game Pass Ultimate subscriber, connect your account and you're off to the races. If you're new.
Yeah. I mean, Harrison and the team have done a great job making that as easy as possible. And we're trying to make sure it's as easy as possible to get new Game Pass subscribers as well. So
yeah. So you can check it out. It's awesome, dude. Mike, thanks again for your help. And thanks again for hiring me many years ago. So great to talk to you, my friend.
Great. Catching up with you again, and keep up the good work.
Okay, those are some great interviews. Thank you to Maja, Chad, John, Mike, and Harrison. Whew, a lot of guests this week.
it was a great week, and congratulations to Samsung for launching and Overwatch 2 beta. It's a week of fun, and congratulations for people that have launched stuff, right, Jeff?
Yeah, real quick about the Samsung experience of playing the Xbox app. Look, we work for Xbox, and we're going to say good things about it. That's not going to be surprising to you or me or anyone here. I highly encourage you, if you know anyone with a 2022 model of a Samsung smart TV, and it hits really all of them, it doesn't have to be the highest end one, try it out, because playing is believing with this. Even if you're someone who's been like, cloud gaming hasn't been for me, maybe you've tried it on mobile or something like that, and it hasn't been for you, try it on this TV, and you will be. We've shown it at different events. I've gotten to play it a few different times, and I was like, I forget I'm playing on cloud. It really is that good. So I would love to hear what you think about it. I know we all would, but I highly encourage you to look at it. And it's just pretty cool to know, like, the next TV I buy will probably just like have an Xbox effectively built into it, and so I'll have another room that has an Xbox in it. Looking forward to that.
Yeah, it's very exciting to see how that is received and how people play and what's going on there. I mean, it's such an amazing experience, an amazing time for us now, because you can play Xbox games without an Xbox. You can play some of them on PC, you can play some of them on your phone, but your Xbox is in the cloud. So Samsung TVs are unlocking, this is, like I said in the interviews, it's one brick in the road to our 3 billion gamers. So There we go.
All right.
Anything else? I think
can't touch an analogy Rebecca, like that, Larry. I mean,
no, I know. Rebecca, I think your mic is muted again for some reason. So you might want to check that out. You still there?
You know what? It's because there was street noise. I'm sorry. I need to be more That's responsible. Okay. I like muted myself because there was a loud truck going by and then I forgot. Ugh, sorry, I'm usually a lot better about it.
Oops. That's
out of practice. Been gone for 3 weeks. So
glad we have you back though. But listen, I want to thank Jeff. I want to thank you for the Overwatch interview. It's always great to talk to that team. Looking forward to that. Thanks to all the guests that came on, like you said, Rebecca. And Rebecca, thank you to you. I know you're busy with Minecraft Creator and all the rest of our regular day job. So I really appreciate you you all coming in and spending some time with us and the listeners. So thank you, everybody. Any final words before we let everybody go?
This is the best hour of the week. I get to get all done up for once and chat with you guys and nerd out about stuff. So it's nice to be back.
Larry, where are we supposed to be getting done up?
Yeah, I know. Come on, put in a little effort, guys. No, oh,
man. Sweatpants and
Jeff, do you have pants on this week at least? I mean,
yes.
It's been hot in Seattle, right?
That was one day, and we're back to it.
That was one day.
All right, no weather talk.
And we're back to talking about the weather.
Nope, you did this.
All right, gang. We're gonna let everybody go on behalf of everybody here at Xbox. Thanks again for listening. Thank you for all your support. We'll be back next week. With more interviews, more games, a lot of fun. Bye-bye, everybody.